Good morning, campers and fellow geezers. Well, we're hitting the road. This episode is going to take us from Washington through Idaho, Montana, and into Wyoming. And I'm going to be able to show you the three campgrounds that we stayed at along the way. So more of a campground review, and I'll talk a little bit more about our membership and why we're only paying $4 to $15 per night for some of these places. So stay tuned and welcome to GeezerViz. Well, we made it to Ponderosa Falls RV Park. This park here is our membership park. I think it's called our home park. It's one of the few K&M properties that are in Washington State that we bought into. And we were able to buy into Resort Parks International plan because we had this as our home park. So that's what the Resort Parks International is, more nationwide with resorts, where this is K&M is only here in Washington State. So to stay here, the only thing I had to pay for was the 50 amp power, which comes out to $4 a night. So five nights here cost me a whole whopping 20 bucks plus tax. So it's a nice park. It's got lots of amenities, the swimming pool, the hot tub, basketball court, little putt-putt golf area. Yeah, so it's a nice area. It's really close to Spokane, Washington. There's a couple of disc golf courses nearby, so I went and played those. Yeah, I could see myself coming back here and spending more time here and exploring the area. Higher! Higher!
Okay.
But don't fall out.
I won't, I won't. I'm afraid I'll
can't get enough exercise just being out and about. Here you go. Little tiny exercise room. Come around the corner this way. There's the swimming pool. Sauna. Ooh, that's hot. I don't care for saunas. I don't like being hot. Lightly wooded campground. Here's the play area. Some of the RV sites in the distance. There's the main office up in there, plus another room. We'll look at that in a bit. Got a place over here where you can do some grilling. Right in there. More outdoor seating. Outdoor seating by the swimming pool. Thank you. Falls. Now, I don't know if that's chemicals in the water that's turning it blue or just coloring. Anyway, we'll try it later. Looks like fun. Well, we made it to the Conestoga campground in White Sulphur Springs, Montana. We left Spokane, went across the Idaho Panhandle. It was uphill the whole way. And once you get to the very top, you start heading down the other side, you enter into Montana. So, Idaho, it was a lot of cedar trees, fir trees, beautiful forested area. Get down to the other side of the pass heading into Montana. Kind of gives way to some pine tree forests, and then you get to see the colorful changing of the leaves, you know, some of those trees that are changing color this time of year. And then kind of into the rolling hills of Helena, Montana. We went through there, and then I can't tell you exactly where we went except more east and more north. Until we got up here to White Sulphur Springs. Never been here before. It's a nice enough campground. Very much out into the open. You can see the sun setting behind me here. Let me flip the camera around here and kind of give you a wider view of the RV park. So we're here for next 5 nights. I'm not sure exactly what we're going to do here. There is a town called White Sulphur Springs. It's very small. So we'll probably go check that out. And then there's really not anything that's really close by. So we'll probably just hang out here, do our little art projects. Barb's got some sewing that she wants to get done. I'm still working on some diamond art. Of course, I'm going to work on some videos too. And hang out here for the next 5 days before we start heading south. And our next stop from here will be in Wyoming, a little town called Boulder, Wyoming. Another place I've never been. So it's going to be a lot of more rural roads getting there, staying off of 15 and I-90 and kind of taking some back roads. So it should be a lot of fun. Anyway, here we are. Just woke up, letting the dog out. So much for finding nice warm weather. 29 degrees out this morning. We're in Pinedale, Wyoming. Can hear the busy road next to us. This is a membership park. The only thing I can say about it is that it has full hookups. That's about it. So other than that, I'm glad it's only $10 a night. We're only here for 3 nights because they close this park down and close it for the winter. It's starting to get cold. I guess 29 degrees, right? Their water pipes will start to freeze, and so they just they shut it down, blow the pipes out, and just keep the park closed until, I guess, spring. So let me flip the camera around. You can kind of see the park behind me, but it's not very big. There you go. There's the entire campground. Pretty sunrise. Like I said, full hookups, no amenities. It's called the Wind River Campground near Pinedale, Wyoming, which is about an hour south of Jackson, Wyoming, which was very beautiful up there. Wish I would have gotten some images or some video of us coming through Jackson. Very steep, very pretty. It was a 10% downgrade, which is, I think, the steepest downgrade I've gone. But I was so busy handling the coach and using my Jake brake to get down safely, probably only going about 25, 30 miles an hour down this windy, steep road. It was all I could do just to handle the coach. But it was gorgeous up there. I'd like to go back up there maybe when it's not so cold. Oof. Another part of motorhoming with a big diesel pusher is that you have to use this product called DEF, diesel exhaust fluid. And you need to put it in a tank every so often. So I go through about 2.5 gallons of DEF, probably every couple fill-ups of the diesel tank. So after a couple hundred gallons of diesel, I've used about 2.5 gallons of DEF. And in this coach, I have a 10-gallon DEF tank, and I could fill it up at the truck stops, but I instead prefer just to use the jugs I get at Walmart. Here's a picture of one. So there you go. There's a diesel exhaust fluid, and it's going to go in that tank right there. Just all part of the joy of owning a motorhome. One thing I have noticed, and I've said it in earlier videos, is stuff's gonna break on these things. And I guess it's kind of like a boat. You're always throwing money into them. These big rigs are no different, and I've had a couple more things break. And some things I fixed have broken again. So it's a never-ending process. So on our way down to Arizona, guess what? We get to stop by National Indoor RV Center again to have them do more work on the coach. It's all part of the adventure. New one. Doesn't fit. New one of these. Got it. This one actually worked, and this is a very old one that I had in my car. I didn't have to use this, which was going to be my last resort. So here we go. If you don't like to do maintenance, like a lot of maintenance, don't buy a motorhome. Oh. Okay, I'm down here in between the slides. So, got one slide right there behind me and the big slide right here. So down here, sitting on this little stool between the slides, this rig has something called AquaHot. And AquaHot is a furnace that will give us propane heat. It also will heat the fluid that's in the hoses that run underneath our floor to give us in-floor hydronic heat. And it also heats our hot water either by propane, or there's also an electric burner that will heat the hot water if we just need a little bit. Maybe enough for two quick showers, and then that's all. But if I turn the propane on, then I've got hot water for as long as I need it. So this AquaHot system uses transfer fluid. So here's the transfer fluid that I need to put in, and it needs to go in that tank right there. And right here is the hot water, or the hot AquaHot level. So I need to put that much transfer fluid in. It does evaporate out, so you do have to put it in occasionally. However, I put it in up here and there's no room for me to lift this big jug up there to put it in. So I have these little squeeze bottles that I use to put the transfer fluid in. So sometimes you have to be a little bit creative in how you do your maintenance on the rig. Because this area is nice and warm in here, look who else likes the spot in here. Yeah, it's full of rat droppings. I've also got poison in here, which hasn't been touched. So, anyway, gotta put in the fluid. Alright, I guess it's about 16 ounces. It took almost the whole thing. So, there we go, up to the hot line. I'm good to go. Here's the area I squeezed in to put the AquaHot in. You can see the two slides right there, my little stool right there, and there's the AquaHot system. One thing I found pretty interesting here is that the power company got tired of big osprey nests on their telephone poles. Well, what happened is they'd build the nest on the telephone poles and the debris would fall down on the power lines and cause issues. So what they did is they did this. They put up poles with platforms on them so the osprey could make their nests there. I don't know if they put a starting nest there or the ospreys have done that on their own, but this keeps the birds off of the power poles, which are just right over here by the road. Those don't have nests on them. This platform here looks like a perfect place to live if I was a bird. In this video, I've talked a lot about membership parks, and that's how we planned the route this time, is just to hit a number of those membership parks. And earlier, I showed that we pay about $400 a year for our two memberships combined. And so, so if you figure that I'm paying anywhere between, on this trip, $4 and $15 a night for a park that would normally charge between $40 and $60 a night, you can see there's a big savings there, and it does not take me that long to recover that $400. Of course, to be able to join the K&M park originally, I had to pay out thousands of dollars for a membership fee, but that was, you know, more than a decade ago. That money's long gone, and those memberships are quite a bit more expensive now. So I think these continue to save us money, and so we'll continue to do this as long as we travel. if we ever find where we're just gonna snowbird, just drive straight someplace, park the rig, wait for winter to get over, just drive straight home. Maybe then I'll give up the memberships. But for now, they're working pretty good. The only downside is there's not a membership park in every single town that you wanna visit. There's a number of them. And like I said, I planned my route based on where these parks were. So that's one way to do it. Or you just use your memberships where you can and just pay full rate when you're not in a membership park. I think it still saves money. So I'm gonna go ahead and end this video here. Next up, we're gonna talk about our trip through Utah, down into Nevada, and eventually into Arizona. So stay tuned and we'll see you next time.